Gentlemen, you know, today is a class where I just want to tell you a few issues, talk to you a few issues related to bladder outflow obstruction. This might seem a bit of a repetition because you had a very good webinar last Saturday, if I'm not mistaken, when Paul Abraham, Sanjay Sinha, Nitin, all these people discussed that as part of the USI webinar. But they were specifically related to various other issues to the bladder in relationship to bladder. Today, I'm just going to focus on some very basic things related to bladder outflow obstruction and how we may be able to manage some of these patients who have difficulty with voiding. Different case scenarios are there. Some of them are common questions which patients ask and which you may be faced with when you go out into the world. The first is actually a 40-year-old gentleman who was evaluated for LUTS. He was found to have a marginally elevated creatinine and bilateral hydronephrosis on ultrasound. He had a post-void residue of 100 and a CMG confirmed bladder outflow obstruction. So, you know, we're not going to discuss why, when, what. This is the fact. So he has got bladder outflow obstruction, and this is not pelvic floor dyssynergia or anything. This is primary bladder neck obstruction. The issue here is he has been married for 6 months. His wife is 28 years old and is not pregnant. So this is the case that we have. And the question that needs to be addressed is in what is put in the square box. That is, the patient has been married for 6 months. Wife is 28 years old. He's not pregnant. And you're faced with a gentleman who has got confirmed bladder outflow obstruction with marginally elevated creatinines. I'm sure you must have seen patients in this category during your training or in your practice. So the first question is there a role for drug treatment in such a patient? Would anybody like to answer that? Is there a role for, say, alpha blockers in this patient? There is a role for, it doesn't matter, I'll carry on. There is a role for drug treatment. I mean, you have, this is a tricky situation where you have a patient who has got primary bladder neck obstruction, who is not married, and you're worried that any treatment here in terms of bladder neck surgery could result in retrograde ejaculation. That is a worry, isn't it? That is a worry that you may have retrograde ejaculation and therefore, his wife may not get pregnant. And that is the consent form that you have to take. When you sign the consent form, you have to tell these patients who have this problem. So he may decide that he doesn't want to have treatment because his wife is not pregnant and she's a young girl. So is there a role for drug treatment? Yes, of course there is a role for drug treatment. That means you can actually give this patient alpha blockers and see what happens to him. Closely monitoring his creatinine, his PVR, his basically his symptoms. But does it actually work is the issue. And if it does work, how good is it working? We don't know the answer to this question. It is a fact that these patients are given drugs. There's no doubt about it. But there was a study which was carried out, and there was a paper which was published in the IJU from Christian Medical College, Bangalore. And they looked at this particular problem. And they found that patients who have high voiding pressures, that means on the CMG, if your detrusor pressures are in excess of 80 centimeters of water, it is highly unlikely that you will have significant drug benefit, significant benefit with alpha blockers. And that is an opinion that I also firmly believe in, that if the voiding pressures are very high, these guys are in danger of slow progressive renal failure. And we have seen some of these patients actually come up later on for transplantation where this diagnosis has been missed. So I would say that, well, you could try the drugs, but be very careful whether they work. But the bottom line is that if the retrusor pressures are high, then you may be veering towards offering some form of surgery for such a patient. So the surgery is actually bladder neck incision, a very simple procedure. It is not the Orandi TUIP. There's a slight difference between a bladder neck incision and a transurethral incision of the prostate. Here you just need to cut the bladder neck. Now, what is the risk? The risk here of retrograde ejaculation. We know that if you do a standard TURP, the risk of retrograde ejaculation varies from 50 to 90%. Standard TURP, retrograde ejaculation. It's not 100%. So, you know, everybody, there are some patients who after TURP are able to ejaculate. You take a history from them, they will tell you. But generally speaking, if you have a TURP patient, his risk of retrograde ejaculation is very high, right? So we tell them that. We tell all these patients to have it. But what about a single incision bladder neck? We know that if you have a patient, suppose this patient was married, he's got kids, and he's got high voiding pressure, then most people would probably do an incision at 7 o'clock and 5 o'clock. But in such a patient who's unmarried, a single incision, just cutting the bladder neck, will solve the problem. At the same time, what is the risk of retrograde ejaculation is a question that we need to answer. There was a study done by Pauline Hennes sometime back, and this was done in boys actually and published in journal Frontier Pediatrics. And where they showed, they had this bladder neck incision done in young boys for primary bladder neck obstruction. They followed them up 20 years after surgery and found that not one of them actually had retrograde. All of them had antegrade ejaculation. So just a small little cut at the bladder neck, the fibers to be released. And actually, when you do this operation, single incision, say at 7 o'clock or 5 o'clock, just cutting the bladder neck is sufficient enough for these patients to drop their detrusor pressures and at the same time actually have antegrade ejaculation. Turner Warwick actually has looked at this himself, and he has felt that if you have a single incision bladder neck, then the chance of retrograde ejaculation is less than 5%. And if you do it at 5 and 7, then it's about 15%. So bladder neck incision does, in a large percentage of patients, preserve antegrade ejaculation. Generally speaking, if you do a single incision bladder neck, excluding Turner Warwick's figures, if you just look globally, then the data says that if you do a single incision BNI, then your risk of retrograde ejaculation varies from 0 to 16% at best. So really, this is a good choice, actually. This is a good choice in such a patient. And personally, I have not had to regret doing a single incision bladder neck on patients with high voiding pressures. So if you ask me, many of them have come, they're already on alpha blockers and they are sent and they have this problem of high voiding pressures. Bilateral hydro, I am actually worried. If they're really worried, you could go ahead and have 7 cryopreservation, etc. And still carry on if you want to have pregnancy, or give them a chance and say, okay, you carry on. You recently remarried. You carry on with alpha blockers for a year or two and then see, keep on regular follow. But the bottom line is that if your detrusor pressures are high, then it's highly unlikely that you will benefit and you may continue to progress towards renal insufficiency. What about clean independent self-catheterization? This guy is not voiding. He's got high voiding pressures. He's got bilateral hydro. Can he be managed with CIC? Of course. You discuss the option of self-catheterization, which means he cannot void at all. He will have to catheterize himself 4-5 times a day. He's got a sensate urethra. But if he is happy with it and if he can manage with it, so be it. There is a slight risk of urinary tract infection. Remember, his high voiding pressures, etc., and the hydronephrosis could be also, there could be an element of poor compliance in such a patient. And therefore, these patients are at higher risk for UTIs. They are at a higher risk for epididymitis. So, you know, this guy is unmarried. You put him on CIC. If he gets epididymitis, then again, you know, you could get infection, epididymal abscess, etc. And then you may have to go in and drain this, which means that his seminal function will also be compromised to a large extent. So while he can be managed with CIC, it's an option that you can consider. So these are all the things that you can actually discuss, knowing fully well that they are not the best. They will not answer the issue. they will not answer the question of reducing the true of pressures, which is what you want in such a patient with marginally elevated creatinine. So this in a nutshell would be how you would look at a patient who has this sort of problem. Let's move on to a slightly different scenario. It's an 80-year-old man with one episode of acute urinary retention, painful. And there was no prior history of LUTS, which again is not unusual. No predisposing factors. He has a successful trial void. That means you've given him whatever is necessary. He's had a successful trial void. He's voiding. His prostate is about 50 grams. He's a diabetic. He's hypertensive. He's got poor cardiac reserve. His ASA is 3. So that's in a nutshell this chap, 80-year-old man, successful trial void, ASA 3. Will you manage him with drugs? Of course. You have a largish prostate. He has had a successful trial void, so you probably did give him alpha blockers and manage the trial void situation. If there was a risk factor like constipation, etc., in such a patient, you might have to take care of that because that could have tipped him into AUR. So you could manage this patient with drugs, being a prostate which is larger than about 30 cc. He will require a combination of alpha blockers and 5 ARIs. Now, which is the alpha blocker that you would choose is again related to his cardiac status. And therefore, you probably might choose cilnidocin in such a patient who has got cardiac compromise, ASA grade 3, who has actually got even poor cardiac reserve as far as we can see. So the question is, will you offer him a TURP? I think the risk is high. He's 80 years old. He's voiding now. He's not in retention. His risk of going into retention may be there, may not be there. So if you take care of all the other factors, if he's on any drugs, if he's immobile, if he had a problem recently, then you might decide not to offer him a TURP. You take care of those situations. And you have to look for whether there are any other minimally invasive techniques that you could employ in such a patient. He's got retention of urine. He's got poor cardiac reserve. And the worry here is whether he'll go into retention again. You don't know. So the first choice would be to give him drugs, keep him on close follow-up. But just for discussion's sake, would there be any other minimally invasive techniques that we could employ? Yes, some people say that, well, you could do a HOLEP for him instead of a TURP. Many people would do HOLEP for him because they say less blood loss. You can use, you don't need to use glycine. You don't have a problem of fluid. The risk is less. These patients may be on anticoagulation and that can be continued if you do a HOLEP. But whatever you say, it is HOLEP is a procedure again. But you know, compared to TURP, maybe some people who are experts at HOLEP would say that HOLEP has a slight edge in a situation like this. But are there any other minimally invasive techniques that are available today for such a patient, if at all he fails another trial void? If he fails another trial void, you have got to discuss and see, find out whether his risk of surgery is so high that he may just be on an SPC or a urethral catheter. There are many patients who have got poor cardiac reserve and they're very happy to be on an SPC. Don't think it's an infradig situation to be on SPC in a patient who's got poor cardiac reserve. He gets retention. It's not a good situation for him. And you don't want to have a patient who comes into the clinic walking but goes out towards the graveyard. You don't want that situation because it's not a good thing. So therefore, you could go ahead and say, all right, your condition is bad. You've got retention again. If you go into retention, these are the other options. You could put an SPC or you could put a catheter for it. What about other minimally invasive techniques? I will come to that other minimally invasive techniques. But what we are talking about are two important issues. One is prostatic artery embolization or prostatic urethral lift. All right, these are two techniques which have now slowly coming in. The PUL or prostatic urethral lift, there is good amount of data now on this particular technique. And it is good to offer this in a patient who you think requires TURP, who fulfills the other criteria. It is done under local anesthesia. You can do it for a 50 gram prostate. If you have basically good lateral lobes, so you do a flexible cystoscopy in the outpatient, assess it. If he has a, what they call an anterior channel, you know, they've called, if you have an anterior channel, that means the middle lobe is not very large. The middle lobe can be two varieties. One is it can be large and really occluding, and the other, it can be like a ball valve and flop over when the patient is voiding. So you do a flexible cystoscopy and make sure that he doesn't have a large middle lobe, which is actually occluding the lumen. There is no anterior channel. If there is an anterior channel, then you can still go ahead in these patients and offer a prostatic urethral lift. The bottom line here is you must have compressible prostate. And these are all benign enlargements of the gland. And therefore, if you have compressible prostate, you can go up to 80 grams. There are some reports now indicating that between 80 to 100 grams, you can still offer a PUL. But the original data, everybody felt that they started off with smaller prostates, and slowly as their expertise evolved, they went on to do large prostates, and up to 80 grams is it. So this man can actually be offered a PUL in this situation. What about the role of stents? Prostatic stents are available. There are basically two varieties of stents. One is a permanent stent, implantable, and where epithelialization occurs. That means taking out such a stent is very difficult. If for some reason it has to come out, it's very difficult. This was the original Euroloom, which now seems to have fallen out of favor because of its problems. And now we've got these, non-epithelializable stents. And there are actually four generations of these stents now. And the most popular one is actually the Memocath. So the Memocath stent is a thermolabile sort of stent, and you can put it, you can position it well. And the beauty of this stent is that it can very easily be removed. You know, the whole stent can be removed just by pulling the tail end of it, it comes out. So this is an advantage, and it can be positioned well. Once you can move the position a bit, whereas the Euroloom, once you fix it, you can't fiddle around the position. The other stents, the first generations, which were all actually made of stainless steel, the second generation made of nitrilol. This one is a titanium nitrilol stent, which is a Memocath thermolabile stent. So this is a good stent that can be used. The other stent, which is actually what is called the fourth generation stent, again made of the same material, is a rhomboid shape. So actually when you put the stent, it maintains the prostatic lumen in the shape of a rhomboid. So there is a passage which is open. And if you really want to read about these stents, then I think you can actually look at a journal, which is an open access journal. It's published by Dove Publications, and the article is written by Noor Buckles from Bartholomew's in London. So it's a good review article on the current status of stents. So this is an exam question. Many people will ask this both in the theory, what is the role of stents? So this gives you a good comprehensive view of the stents. As far as the prostatic urethral lift is concerned, I would refer you to a nice article written by a guy called Walsh in the Canadian Journal of Urology, June 2017, prostatic urethral lift. And in fact, this gives a good account of this. Now, can you do prostatic? You know, if you remember, the first case that I showed you was a young man, a 40-year-old guy who wants to preserve ejaculation. He hasn't have got a child. So can you offer him a prostatic urethral lift? Well, actually, you can. You can actually offer him a prostatic urethral lift. Again, the problem is when the if the bladder neck is very high, you might have to do a technique which is called stacking. So if you read this article, it will talk about it. Stacking means you put two or three of those, one above the other, one below the other. You stack up the implant so that you open the bladder neck wide in such a patient. So it is possible to offer that particular patient, the young guy, a prostatic uterus stent. And this can be done easily under local anesthesia. If you want to offer a pudendal block, you can do it under pudendal block. Another useful way by which you can actually give good analgesia and anesthesia while you're doing cystoscopy is to put 50 cc of xylocaine cold. You put the xylocaine, keep it chilled. Don't keep it warm. Keep it chilled and add sodium bicarbonate to it, a mixture of 50 cc of both together, and put it into the bladder, and it provides good analgesia for the bladder for you to do this procedure or whatever else you want to do. So you read that article in Canadian Journal of Urology, it will give you a good idea. So by doing a prostatic urethral lift, you are able to preserve sexual function, and that first patient, the young man, could be offered this particular technique instead of even a single incision BNI. Okay, we'll move on to the third fellow. This is a 65-year-old gentleman with LUTS who's been on terazosine for 2 years. Now, terazosine is one of the first generation of alpha blockers which were produced, marketed as Hytrin. It was extremely popular and all of us used it. It was a very good drug. It was a very good drug. The recommended dosage for terazosine when it started out was 5 milligrams, increasing to 10 milligrams once a day at night. When we started using it in India, all the senior urologists found that quite a lot of our patients were not able to tolerate the 5 mg dose. So we reduced the dose. We gave them 2 mg and then it came down to even 1 mg. So 1 mg Hytrin was being marketed, and there are still patients on this 1 mg of Hytrin even now. They don't want to change it. So even 1 mg Hytrin was a good drug. So it is a good drug, but you know, market forces are such, technology improves, pharmacology improves. You want to be more specific. You want to be more targeted in targeting your therapy specifically to the alpha blockers which are residing in the prostate and not have a general effect. So that's the reason why we now move on to more uroselective blockers, as they call it. So here was a patient who was on terazosine for 2 years. He had moderate symptoms. His IPSS before treatment was 20 by 35, and his IPSS after treatment was 16 by 35. So he was put on Tamsulosin, simply because, sorry, he was not Tamsulosin, moderate improvement, this should treat as terazosine. So there was moderate improvement with terazosine. He felt symptomatically better. But you know, when patients come, this is what you will find. You'll find a patient who's already on terazosine for years together. He's come to you. Somebody said, go and see a urologist. A new guy has come to town. Go and see him. You're trained to use a better drug. So you want to know whether he will benefit with a change to a monoselective alpha block. That's a difficult question to answer, because if you look at the data, all of them actually were the same. The studies that were done did not actually show any difference between terazosine, doxazosine, tamsulosin. Remember one thing, the MTOP study that was done, the landmark MTOP study that was done, did not use monoselective alpha blockers. The drug that was used was doxazosine, a cardiac drug, basically antihypertensive. And with that, they showed, they did the study. So really, there's not much of a difference in how patients feel. So if he will benefit with a change to a monoselective, he may benefit, he may not benefit. He's already had some benefit here, and he seems to be happy. He just wants your concurrence when he comes to see you. Okay, you continue to take it if you're happy. PVR, you do the standard evaluation and find out that nothing wrong has happened, and he's tolerating the drug well, let him continue the drug. There's no need to change to something different just because it's available in the market. Will he benefit with the addition of a 5-ARI? Again, that depends on the volume of the prostate, which we have not been told. So if his prostate volume is higher, then you could add a 5-alpha reductase inhibitor to the existing terazosine so that he has a little bit more benefit in his outcome. Are there any investigations necessary before the above decisions are made? I think you need to check his post-void residue. You need to get his history right. You need to look at his IPSS score. And also at the same time, just make sure he's not had any urinary tract infection in the interim period and that he's not holding back significant amount of residual urine. It is not mandatory to do a uroflow because it's not going to change much. The amount of benefit you accrue in your uroflow with any of these alpha blockers is at best about 2 ml per second. So really, it's not going to be a dramatic improvement in your uroflow. So that's not necessary. But what is more important is to make sure that you're emptying your bladder, you've got no infection, and then you can just go ahead and do everything else. Because these are things that would be necessary. Some people might argue and say, what about a creatinine? Well, most of these patients are usually diabetics or hypertensives, and creatinine has been done in many of these patients. But if it has never been done, you look at his notes, if never been done, it's worthwhile having a baseline creatinine simply because we don't have good GP facilities where all these tests are done. The patient may come to the clinic for the first time ever, never having had a creatinine done, you may find that it may be marginally elevated. So it's a good test to have. So basically, these are the three investigations that you would like to do in such a patient. And whether really he will benefit with a change to an alpha blocker is anybody's guess. So the data does not seem to support that. It's just that the data supports that monoselective thing does not have too many side effects. That's all they're saying. Let's move on to another situation where you have a 70-year-old man with hypertension and same LUTS, and he can be managed with drugs. The WHO data, if you recall, long time ago, the WHO, when the second BPH consortium took place in Paris, the WHO had produced a good booklet. And that booklet indicated that only 10% of men in the entire world who have prostatic symptoms actually require surgery. Okay? 10% only required surgery. 60% could be managed with drugs. The rest probably needed nothing at all. So 60 to 70% of patients can be just treated with drugs, and the rest don't have too many symptoms and need not actually have to be bothered about. So only 10% of men actually require surgery. So, you know, prazosin, Minipress XL as it is marketed, prazosin, is a good drug for the control of hypertension. So many patients were actually put on this drug earlier on, 2.5 milligrams daily for the control of hypertension, once a day. It's a long acting. The question now arises, he's got LUTS now, he's already on an alpha blocker, prazosin. By increasing the dose to 5 milligram, can we take care of both hypertension and LUTS? That is the question that's to be answered. And if we do not do that, if we add tamsulosin, will he suffer from postural hypertension? Two alpha blockers. Well, currently, nobody would use prazosin as a first-line drug for the treatment of essential hypertension. There are better drugs available. So the EAO guidelines would indicate that none of these drugs are actually to be used for the treatment of hypertension, and you have better drugs, and therefore this is going to be a highly unlikely situation for you. So even if you do have this patient on prazosin, you're probably better to convert him to a better antihypertensive, one of these ACE inhibitors, etc., which are much better than this particular drug. By adding tamsulosin, he wants to know whether by increasing the dose of prazosin to 5 mg, Now, the dose of prazosin, which is recommended for the control of hypertension, is not 5 mg/xL. 5 mg/xL is for pheochromocytoma. Okay? And even the dose for control of hypertension is not in the range of 2.5. It's even less. So, this particular patient probably needs his antihypertensive medication to be readjusted to a better drug. And certainly, if he's got LUTS, you can add him on tamsulosin. So there are many patients who are on two drugs. One is the TAMS alpha blocker. He's also on some other drug for hypertension, and they don't have any problem. So you can add it. So my reading of the situation is that it may be better to take off prazosin in this patient, put him on a better antihypertensive, and because he's got LUTS, you start him on tamsulosin. Okay. We have move on to the next one. We have a 55-year-old man with LUTS who has already been treated with tamsulosin. He comes back to the clinic 3 months later, and his IPSS score is 7/35. He has a Euroflow of 4 mils and avoided volume of 150, and his post-void residue is 150. The question that we need to ask here is, will you continue with medical management in this patient? Well, one post-void residue is not sufficient. His IPSS score is still low. That means the amount of bother that he has is not much. But we know that many patients don't have significant bother, but they do have problems with their bladders. They do have problems with their kidneys. His Euroflow is very poor. A Euroflow of 4 mils per second. If you do urodynamics, you will realize that his AG number is significantly high, much more than 40. So he would be theoretically obstructed in many of these situations. Of course, you might turn around and argue that, well, he could be having a hypocontractile detrusor. And that's the reason why probably he's not benefiting much his IPSS score. But he's got no bother at all. His PVR is still 150. So here's a man, if he still got this, you could continue with the drug management. But because he's got a high PVR, this is the sort of patient where you would probably like to do urodynamics and find out whether he's actually obstructed or he's not obstructed. Okay, is he got a good detrusor? Is he got a bad detrusor? Ultimately, because he's only 55, you would like to be sure that you're dealing with somebody who might benefit with a better line of approach. So while you can actually continue with medical management because the bother is low, it would not be prudent to do so. You would rather evaluate such a patient, make sure that he's safe urodynamically or he's obstructed or whatever, and then decide if his PVR continues to remain, then you're probably, with such a poor flow rate, you're probably better off offering him some form of corrective surgery to improve his outcome. So urodynamics, and take it from there. I'm sure that you would have listened to Paul Abraham last week when he discussed this issue of urodynamics, and we get the impression that most patients do have, in his book, most patients who have to have bladder outflow surgery do have urodynamics to make sure that the surgery is going to benefit them at all. So we move on to probably the final one for today. I think the time is half past. Yes, getting on to half an hour. So we move on to the final one with a 58-year-old male who's got urodynamically proven bladder outlet obstruction and he's sexually active. Will you offer him a prostate surgery? He's got obstruction. I think we discussed this slightly differently in the younger man. The younger man who had bilateral hydronephrosis, it was primary bladder neck obstruction. This is a man who has got prostatic enlargement, 58, sexually active. Will you offer him TURP? Well, because it's sexually active, you will be wondering whether nothing is going to be wrong with his sexual function. He's not going to get impotent after TURP. But as I mentioned some time back, he's going to have definitely retrograde ejaculation. So that can be a very disconcerting situation for him. So you could offer him, after doing flexible cystoscopy, you could offer him prostatic urethral lift. He's got a largish prostate, you could even consider him having a prostatic artery embolization. Both these techniques, both prostatic artery embolization as well as PUL, do not affect ejaculation. So they do preserve their sexual function, they do preserve ejaculation. But prostatic artery embolization is still, we would say, not the standard of care. People are trying it out. There is data slowly emerging. The EAU guideline says that at the moment it's experimental and should not be offered directly unless it's part of a clinical trial. So if you have a patient like this who you want to experiment and try prostatic artery embolization, you could put him on the trial and see whether he benefits. So will you offer him a TURP? I would try and see whether we can offer him some other techniques rather than TURP if they are available. And we know that some of these techniques are becoming available. Now the patient refuses surgery. He doesn't want to have surgery. He's got urodynamically proven bladder outflow obstruction. He refuses surgery. What can you do? Can you continue with drugs? Well, if he's sexually active, if you put him on any alpha blocker, he's likely to have some degree of retrograde ejaculation. If you put him on cilnidocin, definitely he might benefit better, more, but very high rate of retrograde ejaculation. It's well known that the benefit of cilnidocin is assessed by two symptoms a patient has. Number one is reduction of nocturia. Nocturia reduction is a very significant to cilnidocin. And secondly is retrograde ejaculation. So if these two symptoms do appear in a patient, the drug is actually working pretty well. So if he refuses surgery, then you could continue with drugs. What happens to bladder outflow obstruction? Well, he continues to have bladder outflow obstructions. Detrusor pressures may not significantly drop. Will he go? I don't know whether he'll go into retention. But he needs to be on very close follow-up if he does not want surgery, but you can offer any of these. What about a stent in such a patient? You can offer him a stent. You can offer him a stent, certainly. He's a young man. It's just that you would like to offer him these sort of situations. There is actually, in some patients, they have done what is called a stent test. It's not exactly in this sort of patient, but in a patient who's got bladder outlet obstruction and significant detrusor overactivity. And you're not sure whether by doing a TURP, whether this patient will become incontinent because of detrusor overactivity. You know, sometimes you have that fine balance, you're not very certain. So these are patients where you can put a stent and test them out and see whether they become incontinent or not. It doesn't happen to be for this particular patient, but if he does refuse surgery, a stent is an option for such a patient. But stent will remain, keep the bladder neck open. While he may be sexually active, he still could have some degree of retrograde ejaculation. But the best option for him would be a PUL, provided he doesn't have a large median lobe. Nowadays, they are even, unless the median lobe, as I told you, is completely occluding the lumen, there's no anterior channel, and when it is flopping over, that sort of a pedunculated sort of median lobe, which is flopping over, these are right now the real two contraindications for PUL. So we just discussed it. Is it safe to manage the drugs? Yes, we can. Very close follow-up is necessary to make sure that he does not worsen as far as renal failure is concerned, and that he continues to be symptomatically within normal limits. So I've come to the end. This was a short presentation. There was quite a bit was covered in last week's webinar, so I cut it down. So if you have any questions, guys, you ask me, we'll see whether we can. These are the standard.
Sir, there are a few questions on Facebook. I'll just like to present it before you, sir. Hello.
Journals and brush up your knowledge. Prosthetic urethral lift is going to come in a big way. It's a lot of data emerging on that particular technique. It's just the cost at the moment, but it's a very, very attractive way of treating people who don't want to have surgery. Right, do you have any questions?
Sir, there are some questions on Facebook, sir. I would like to ask
you. Sure.
How do you decide between single incision and two incisions in bladder neck?
If the patient, you know, both of them will produce the same effect in terms of voiding. Okay? If you do a single incision, you get a good result. You do a bilateral incision, you get this. You won't get a better result. You'll get as good a result. So it's just the fact that you can do a single incision. Don't look at the endoscopic appearance after that. You will look at one side and then the prostate is falling. It may be obstructed, may not. No, it doesn't look like that at all. It's fine. So if there's a young man, sexually active, you have to do a BNI, you just do a single incision. If he's an older man, you think that, you know, then you can make it. If he's an older man and it's not it's like a TYP then. You're not doing it for primary bladder neck obstruction. You're doing it for a patient who's got a minimally enlargement of the prostate, but who is actually obstructed, and you may get away with the TUIP, the Orandi procedure. Then you do that on both sides at 5 o'clock and 7 o'clock, incising deep into the prostate, including the bladder neck. So single incision versus both incisions.
Yes, sir. So one more. How long should we give drugs in a patient of BPH? Single drug versus combination, and is there a role of decreasing dose after some time?
Yes. Well, most patients are told that they've got to take it lifelong. But sometimes you can actually, after a period of time, you could stop the alpha blockers and continue with the 5-ARIs in such a patient and maintain the prostatic volume down. 2 years, you could try to wean them off one drug and keep them on only a single drug. In many patients, it does reduce the cost also. But most of the patients actually continue to remain on two drugs. As far as I can see, there does not appear to be a concerted effort to actually reduce the dosage to single drug. So that's the way to do it.
Sir, is there any, what is the role of endoscopic evaluation in a patient with BEP?
Well, I think this was discussed on last Saturday's webinar. Endoscopy does not actually confirm obstruction. Okay? Confirmation of obstruction is made on urodynamic parameters. We have the history, we have a baseline uroflow, and we know that if the flow rate is less than 10 ml per second, you have a 90% chance of being obstructed. 90%, not 100%. This is all Paul Abraham's figures himself. So you have a 90% chance of being obstructed if the flow rate is less than 10 ml. So what is the role of endoscopy? Many people actually do a flexible endoscopy in the OPD when a patient comes with LUTS, just to see what is the size of the prostate. Is it a large prostate? Is it small? Can I deal with this in single sitting? Will it require two sittings? Whatever technique you use. I mean, some people would do a single two sitting TURP, some people would do one sitting TURP. So that. The second most important reason for doing a preoperative endoscopy is if you are considering a minimally invasive approach like a prostatic urethral lift, then this becomes a very important tool to identify whether this guy actually would be a candidate for PUL. You need to decide that with a flexible endoscopy. Anyway, most people are doing PUL under local anesthesia. So you could use this opportunity to say, okay, I'll assess your prostate and proceed to the prosthetic used to live under the same anesthetic and be done with it. However, if you want to choose to do it a different way, then you okay, you bring him into your office, into the clinic, you do a flexible scopy and say, well, your median lobe is too enlarged, it's not a good idea. Your prostate is not compressible. As I told you, you need compressible prostate. That is why in some patients who have had even radiotherapy or brachytherapy, if they do have obstruction, some people have tried prostatic urethrolift because the prostate is still compressible. So the key point is your prostate must be compressed because the clips that you put actually compress the prostate from within and right up to the capsule. So it holds it out in place and opens up the chamber, the channel. That is the basic idea. So you put in two on each side, these clips that they are, and then they keep the prostatic fossa open. Sometimes you have to put three. So that's the PUL is a good way. That's why flexible cystoscopy is a good idea if you're planning to do such a procedure. Otherwise, there is no role unless you're thinking that, well, I'm evaluating somebody as part of hematuria. I have done all the investigations. I can't find a tumor, but I just want to be sure that because he's an older man, I want to be sure that it's not from the bladder or from the prostate. Such a patient can then have a flexible cystoscopy or a rigid cystoscopy just to make sure that the bleeding is not from vesicle piles. So that's the other reason why you would actually like to do a scopy. But apart from that, really, no other indication before you want to do prostate surgery.
So one more question. Is it necessary to resect tissue between the two incisions while doing VNI?
There's a strange operation which I find in many centers. It's called BNI TURP. It's a TURP. There's no reason to do the intervening tissue. It looks like, as I said, it looks like that. When you do an incision on either side, then this sort of prostate in the middle tends to bulge up. And you think that, oh, it might cause an obstruction. Another guy who scopes such a patient after 5 to 10 years, again shows lower. But if you look at original Orandi's data for prostates, which are less than 30 grams, this is a great operation. It should be used more rather than anything else. But you know, surgeons being surgeons, they want to resect, and so therefore they think that this tissue that looks bulging in the middle is actually going to obstruct. It actually doesn't obstruct. It doesn't obstruct at all. And therefore you're quite safe in doing incision and leaving this tissue behind. If it doesn't appeal to your eye, then you take it off. It's not going to add any benefit as well.
Okay, sir. Sir, one more. What are the measures?
You have another question?
What are the measures to be taken during TURP to prevent?
Any other question?
Yes, sir. Hello, can you hear me, sir? Am I audible?
Got up.
Yes, sir. Am I audible?
Any other queries?
Yes, sir. Sir, what are the measures to be taken during TURP in order to prevent ejaculatory dysfunction?
Well, what is now currently being shown is that if you preserve some tissue at the apex, you may be able to prevent retrograde ejaculation. Personally, I have never actually had to do this, and I resect the prostate. But if you are really concerned and you have to do a TURP and you want to preserve it, you may try to leave. But the theory is that if you leave tissue at the level of the apex, then it tends to preserve ejaculation and not completely make the patient having retrograde ejaculation, to have retrograde ejaculation. So that's the only step that you can do in a TURP. Otherwise, as I said, the incidence of retrograde ejaculation is between 50 to 90%. Campbell tells you that.
Sir, any benefit of giving alpha blockers twice daily? Someone has asked it.
I think we did discuss this sometime back. Well, when psilocybin came into the market, the original Japanese concerned by, I think, Takeda Pharmaceutical, It was 4 milligrams, and they prescribed it 4 milligrams twice a day. And then because of the super selective action and the so-called OCAS technology that they have, it's a slow release. So really one doesn't have to give it at night, where you can give it anytime during the day. So the serotonin is now being given as 8 milligrams at night, but you could give it in the day, or you could give it 4 milligrams twice a day, which is the original study. There was a study again from Japan which used tamsulosin, terazosin, as well as prazosin. These three drugs they use in a trial, but the amount of tamsulosin they use was a very small dose. They use 0.1, the Japanese guys. They use 0.1 milligram of tamsulosin. Again, 0.5 milligrams of prazosin and 1 milligram of hydrate of terazosin. And they found that there was really no difference between the dosages of any of these. And then they finally increased it to 4.4 milligrams of alpha blocker tamsulosin. So I don't see any reason to give it twice a day. The drug is long acting. The technology is such that it allows us to take it once a day. So you don't need to give it twice a day. It doesn't give any added benefit. It might sometimes produce more toxicity if you're not worried, if you're not careful.
One last question, sir. As in our first scenario, a young male, 40 years male, with the documented bladder outlet obstruction.
Yeah.
He was having evidence of renal deterioration as well.
Yes.
In such scenario, if we are starting the patient on medical management,
yes.
Is there any role of medical management? If we are starting on medical management, then what should be the end point? Then at this point, we should convert it into some intervention. Or how frequently we should monitor such patients for renal deterioration?
Well, I would say that initially you need to monitor this patient at least every 3 months, just to be sure that two things are not happening. Number one, his PBR is not increasing. Number two, his creatinine is not rising. He has already got marginal upper tract dilatation, and I think his creatinine might rise, and that is more worrying. So this guy, once you think that your initial follow-up, he has to be on very strict follow-up, initially every 3 months, and then maybe you could say 2 or 3 times a year, but nothing shorter than, or sorry, longer than that. These are very tricky customers, and you know, what could happen is that they could slowly lose their bladder compliance, and then creatinine going up significantly. I had a young man from Australia who had come, and he had this problem, and he was unmarried, and his creatinine was high, and because his bladder was poorly compliant, they put him on both alpha blockers and mirabegron, and when he came here, his creatinine actually was rising. So I told him that this is not a good idea, and you got to decide what you want to do. Of course, he went back to Australia and had his treatment done. He did have a bladder neck incision. He did have a single incision bladder neck ultimately there. So this is something that we are concerned about slowly. I have seen patients who have gone to renal failure because of the simple problem, failure to recognize. So it's a serious enough problem for a young man.
So one last question. Dr. Jay Ganesh has asked, would you recommend TURP in hypotonic bladder with retention?
Very good question. I don't know. I don't think it'll actually benefit with hypotonic detrusor with retention of urine. There are two ways of looking at it. Is this retention of urine in this patient? The residual urine in this patient causing him bother? What is the bother? Recurrent UTIs, incontinence. Two things. That's the only thing that worries. Otherwise, a patient like this, you probably might have to just keep him on medical management and see how he does. You know, these are difficult situations, the hypotonic detrusor. The choice is, if he's an older man, if he's a slightly older man, not a young man, but if he's an older man who could be in the prostatic age group, you could offer him a TUR. You could offer him a TUR with a 50-50 chance that he may void. There are some patients who wipe, and the logic is that, well, you've reduced the outlet resistance a bit in these patients by doing the TURP, and they, whatever little detrusor contraction they have, they can wipe. A nice article by actually Chris Chappell on hypotonic detrusor in, I think, European Urology, and then Journal of Clinical Urology also. So here they have actually, he has said that, yes, there are a group of patients who do benefit with outflow tract surgery in spite of having a hypocontractile detrusor. So, you know, being a, shall we say, a minimally invasive technique, if you feel that the prostate is large enough, endoscopically it is looking obstructed, then you maybe, you might offer him a TUR. So a patient like this, if on rectal exam he's got a reasonably large prostate, your preoperative endoscopy under local anesthesia, another indication, you say, okay, is endoscopically looking obstructed prostate, you could offer him a TUR and then take it from there. Some urologists might offer such a patient, if he's bothered, CIC. You're not emptying your bladder, you've got a poor detrusor, you go on CIC and empty yourself. He's voiding, so some people will say, well, you void and then empty your bladder. So you have the pleasure of doing something in the toilet, you go to the toilet, you pass urine, and then you put a catheter and keep the residue down. So there are various ways by which urologists actually deal with such a situation. And I guess there is no harm if you offer him a TURP, if he's got residual urine, in the hope that he may empty himself, he may be lucky.